2, verse 12. I just want to start out here. We are on our fourth edition of the School of Ministry. There's approximately, I'm going to say 12 to 15 sessions. I'm not quite sure yet if I want to condense it down. But nonetheless, this will be some of the most timeless stuff you'll hear. And if you were to enroll in Bible school this year and go for 4 years, most of the stuff you hear in here, you would not be taught. Because Bible school teaches you hermeneutics, teaches you exegetics, things like that, and it also teaches you how to relate with people. And unfortunately, a lot of Bible schools today are teaching you how to please people rather than please God. And I debated, because the most popular Bible school, and I won't mention their name, but the most popular Bible school right now, School of Ministry, is primarily focused on supernatural things and healing people and laying hands and prophesying. And so as a result, they get tons of students like yourself to come in and practice prophesying and the like. And I'm a firm believer, you don't practice prophesying. You end up prophelying if you do that, all right? Samuel was the youngest prophet to ever live, and nobody had to practice him prophesying. He prophesied by the unction of the Holy Ghost. So if you can teach people how to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, you can get people who know how to prophesy. So we've got to be sure that we don't get people into places that are unscriptural and unspiritual. And that, unfortunately, is what's happened. As a matter of fact, two people from our church went to this most famous Bible school and practiced prophesying and learned how to love your dreams and all that stuff, came back. And now one of them is still smoking weed and the other one knocked up a girl. And that's not an indictment against the Bible school. It's just saying that they must have learned the wrong stuff. And in over 20 years of ministry, I feel completely unqualified. But the Lord reminded me the other day, you've been in this for 20 years. And my approach to this, when Pastor Jeff and I began to talk about it, was, what do? Teach people to pray, prophesy, lay hands on people. And the Lord spoke and said, no, I want you to teach people character. Because character is what's constant. Character is what creates sound people of God. And it was later confirmed by David Ravenhill, who was just at our church last week. Man. Oh, I just, man. Get on Dove TV 2017 on YouTube, and you'll see David's three messages there. Awesome. Just knocked it out of the park. I was so blessed. And he's such a man of God. But I was reading his book, Surviving the Anointing, and as I read it, the Lord spoke to me and said, these are the essentials for ministry. And every title that he had, now I'm not copying his stuff, and by the way, I did tell him I'm doing this, and I told him there's probably going to be a bunch of Surviving the Anointing books bought from North Dakota. So yeah, all right, Brad's got one, awesome. So get the book. There will be a lot of similar stuff, and I'll kind of follow the same lines, but I like to mix my own stuff in it, so I'm not copywriting or anything like that. But the titles themselves were just impeccable, and I thought, this is a school of ministry right here. So I've changed a couple of the titles to fit kind of where I'm going, but if you get that book, you'll basically be, it'll reaffirm everything I've said, and then it'll have some of the sprinklings of my stuff in it from these. So, with over 20 years of ministry, I've seen what not to do, and I've seen what to do. And I feel like the most impeccable thing about ministry, or important thing that we could glean, is how to have good character. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 is one of my favorite scriptures actually in the whole Bible, because it talks about working out your salvation. Scripture that not many ministers can ever define, they don't talk about much. As a matter of fact, I had one minister tell me it does not say work out your salvation, it says walk out your salvation. I said, yeah, right. Read your Bible. Go to the Greek. It says, work out your salvation. But people don't want to explain it because they don't know what that means, because we've always thought that once you're saved, you're always saved. Well, let me maintain. You don't work for your salvation, but you certainly work out your salvation. All right? It's a big difference. One, I don't have it and I'm trying to get it. The other, I have it and I'm using it as a steward to help me become a better person. And that's just what this is all about. Work out your salvation. But notice the interesting thing about working out our salvation. Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, so obedience is a part of working out my salvation, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Notice it doesn't say with love and kindness, with joy and happiness, with peace and coffee, donuts and hot chocolate. It says, work out your own salvation with what? Fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and act his good purpose. Now, that's really significant. You can't have 12 without 13. You work out your own salvation, and if you purpose to do that, God will cause you to will and do his good pleasure. That's awesome. So God does stuff, you do stuff. It's called cooperation. You know, it's not Jesus did it all, I do nothing at all. It's Jesus did it all, and now I can do all things through him. Okay? Do everything without complaining and arguing. Boy, you never see that on somebody's refrigerator. Nervous laughter. So that you may become blameless and pure children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation, in which you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life, in order that I may boast on the day of Christ that I did not labor in vain. Paul's talking to people who he had instructed to live a life of ministry. And he says here, this is what you're supposed to be, a star that holds out the word of life. Difference between a star and a comet is a comet shoots by, everybody's marveled by it, but you never see it after a few minutes. A lot of ministries like that today, a lot of people like that today. A lot of people like that have been in this church, in these meetings. Come up all excited about God. I give my life to you, get baptized, and next thing you know, you never see them again. And they're off doing worse than what they did in the beginning. It would have been better for them not to even come the first time. What happened? They were comets. And they told everybody how in love with Jesus they are, but you never see them again. God wants us to be stars. Stars are constant. You can navigate off the stars. The same stars we look at tonight are the same stars that Abraham and Sarah and when God said, look up at the stars, those are the same stars we see. They are still there tonight, 2,000, 5,000 some years later, 7,000 some years later, whatever it is. That's awesome, because stars are constant. Character should be constant. That's why we call the alphabet characters, because they're always the same. And an A is an A, a B is a B, a C is a C. It never changes. Jesus never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You shouldn't change. When you become a new creation in Christ, you should shine like stars as you hold out the word of life. The problem is when we have night lights holding out the word of life. People who turn off in the day and try and turn on in the night. And some people are the opposite. But we need to be stars. What true ministry is all about is becoming constant. Becoming a person of character, not being a character. All right? Everybody say, I need to be a person of character. People who are constantly fruitful or prolific and who love Jesus and carry out his character represent what true ministry should look like. And we need to live beyond reproach. You know, it's amazing to me how many people will come and tell me how desirous they are to be in the ministry and love God. And you see their Facebook the next day and they're seeing how many beers they can chug. Give me a break. You know what that says to me? You have no fear of God. Because if you feared God, it would keep you away from sin. You know, David Ravenhill said something so profound this week. He said, sin should be like this. You're walking through a dark room and you think that you're trying to pick up the garden hose that's in the garage, but the lights aren't on, and you reach down to grab the garden hose, and you realize it's a snake that you picked up, and do that real quick. That's what sin should be like. But most of us in the church don't hate sin. We just know it's not good for us. So we flirt with it like a little Chinese kid with the King Cobra on Facebook. That's about what the church looks like. Oh, stop it, sin. Oh, I don't like it. I hate you, sin. Yeah, right. We need to hate sin like we hate snakes. You know, what you don't like and what you hate, you have an automatic deterrent to. If you don't like spiders, you're not going to go buy a pet tarantula. If you don't like sin, You're not going to entertain it. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Man, not a lot of preachers talk about sin anymore. It's about our hang-ups or our problems. No, call it what it is. All right, I need to get on. I'm pulling a Charles Spurgeon here or something like that. John Wesley. All right, what we're going to talk about tonight is the ministry of worship. Ministry of worship. This is my opinion, the most essential part of ministry in the whole Bible. The reason why I didn't title it Worship in Ministry is because worship is ministry. I'll never forget this. Dave Morrison said it and it stuck with me for years. Ministry is simply the overflow of my relationship with God spilling into the lives of others. Don't forget that. Ministry isn't how much you do for God. Ministry is how much you worship God and that relationship with Him overflowing into the lives of others. People are directly affected from your relationship with God. If you don't get anything, you have nothing to give away. Hurting people hurt people. Worshipful people reveal God. Worship is this. Write this down. This is so good. Worship is a preoccupation with God regardless of our present circumstances. Worship is when I'm preoccupied with God regardless of my present circumstances. Isn't it funny how most people go to God when something happens wrong? But then when everything's going good, I don't need Him. Most people go to God. I was on an airplane one time, and I heard of another story that was real similar to the experience I had, where this minister was sitting next to an atheist, and he was talking about how big of an atheist he was and all that. Well, they got up in the air, and the plane got into some major turbulence. And as soon as the plane started shaking, the atheist goes, "Oh, God!" And he looks at him and goes, "What the? I thought you didn't believe in God." You know? And it's funny how people will run to God when something's wrong. But when nothing's wrong, see how many beers we can chug. That's not worship. That's not worship. That's a rent of God. A rent of Father. I only get Him when I need Him. No different than going and renting a lift or renting a paint bucket or something like that at a store. We don't serve a rent to God. God isn't our celestial Santa Claus that gives us a toy whenever we pitch a fit. God isn't our genie in a Bible. He's our Father. He's the creator of the universe. He's the one that we're going to stand before on Judgment Day one day and give an account. He is an awesome God. As a matter of fact, He's extravagant. He's almighty. He's wonderful. He's glorious. He's beyond comprehending in one lifetime. I want to find out about that God. And I want to give Him His due place. And I want to worship Him and be preoccupied with Him regardless of my present circumstances. You know what's interesting in Job chapter 1? I think it's verse 17. Right after Satan hits Job's household hard. I mean, takes all of his kids, takes his house, leaves him in a pile of rubble. It was the worst thing that ever happened to a person in the whole scriptures. And he was a righteous, God-fearing man. You know what the first thing he did after all that happened? Read it. Look it up. It says he bowed down his face and he worshipped. And he said, "The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away." And he did not curse the Lord. Even his wife said, "Curse God and die." But he would not curse God. Why? Because no matter what your circumstances, we should worship. You know, you hear people say like, "Hey, everybody, let's worship God. He's been good to me today. He's worthy of your worship whether He's been good to you or not."
Amen.
He's God. We need to worship God regardless as to what's going on in our life. And as a matter of fact, it's better when we do. A.W. Tozer said, "God saved men not to make them just preachers, but to make them worshipers." I love that. God saves men not to make them preachers, but to make them worshipers. See, we think that God saved us so I can go change the world. No, your number one priority and the number one reason God saved you was to make you a worshiper.
Webster's Dictionary, the 1828 version, defines worship as honor with extravagant love and extreme submission. When I worship God, I honor Him with extravagant love and extreme submission. In John 4:23 in the New Testament, we see what God thinks about worship or worshipers. I mean, you know, there's a difference between worship and worshipers. Steve Sampson said if God wanted worship, he'd go buy a CD. Look what it says in John 4:24. Let me bring you up to par as to what's going on here. The woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, Jesus meets her and says he can give her water. She'll never thirst again. You remember that? And he says, well, go get your husband. She goes, I don't have a husband. He goes, that's right. You've had five. And the man you're now living with is not your husband. She goes, I can see you're a prophet. I think that's hilarious. He read her mail, man. And so then in this exchange, look what he says to her. Because she says, well, we don't talk to Jews, and Jews worship on this mountain, and Gentiles this, blah, blah, blah. And it comes to this 23rd verse, and Jesus is saying to her, yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and His worshipers must worship Him in spirit and in word or truth, right? But I want you to go back up to verse 23, the end of it. The Father is spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshipers, say it with me, the Father seeks. Wow! All throughout the Bible tells us to seek God, doesn't it? But right here is the first time the Bible tells us what God seeks in the New Testament. While we're exhorted to seek God, God's exhorting us that He's seeking worshipers. Isn't that interesting? He's not seeking prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, on that last day, He will say, well done, thou good and faithful, or worshiper. I'll show you that in a second. You know, it was a humbling day when I figured out that God's not going to say to me, well done, thou good and faithful evangelist. Well done, thou good and faithful apostle. Well, a lot of us like to get into a position, get a title over our name, and say, well, this is going to save me. But the truth of the matter is, if I walk in an office, apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher, that's simply a contribution to the church, but I still have a personal obligation to be a servant. You can be an apostle and still go to hell. They're called false apostles. You can be a prophet and still go to hell. You can be an evangelist and still go to hell. And the thing that brings you to heaven is not your title or your gifting. Judas was gifted. Saul was gifted, right? Matthew chapter 7, what they say? We drove out demons in your name. We performed miracles in your name. He said, depart from me. I don't know you. In other words, you had giftings, but you didn't have relationship. You were a preacher, but not a worshiper. A pastor, but not a servant. I heard a man, he had a huge epiphany in the middle of his 30-year ministry. He said, I found out I was being a full-time pastor and a part-time believer. Should never be that way. As a matter of fact, true worshipers, if anything ever happens in their church, say a church split or a big problem, they won't even skip a beat. Because their source and sap comes from the Father, not from their church. Now, that's not to say that it doesn't hurt and things like that don't need to be rightly mended, etc. And that's not to say that you can sit home and eat Doritos and watch TBN every Sunday either. The Bible says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together. That's a command, by the way, not a suggestion. It's important for you to get plugged into a good local church. Why? Because they that are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. I can't flourish in ministry unless I'm planted in the house. Amen. And that's not watching TVN. Okay? Bring your whole tithe into the storehouse. That's not Daystar. That's where you're getting fed. That's where you're getting mended. That's where you're getting rebuked. That's where you're getting encouraged, trained, etc. Alright? So, God seeks worshipers. Isn't that amazing? Well, then I want to be a worshiper. If God's seeking worshipers, I want to be a worshiper. Everybody wants to be a prophet now. I want to be so prophetic. I'm a prophesying everybody. I don't want anybody prophesying over me if they haven't spent time in the secret place with Him. Okay? I want to be a pastor. Okay, but you're not going to be a good pastor. You know why David was such a good shepherd? Because he spent time singing to the shepherd, the chief shepherd. See, all of this, all apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, teachers, intercessors, etc., comes from being a worshiper first. The overflow of my relationship with God is what verifies me for my calling in ministry. If you do not worship, you have no right to have a title. And by the way, titles are cheap anyway. Titles are the least form of leadership. You know what? If people have to call you pastor because of what your business card says, there might be a problem there. Because you know when you're in the presence of a pastor or an apostle or a, you know. Because people recognize it. Your gift makes room for you, not your business card. So you just be you, and be a worshiper, and God will promote you. Genesis chapter 22, verse 5, is where worship is the first time mentioned in the Bible. Can everybody say the law of first mention? There's a theological law. I don't claim to be a theologian, but I'm getting closer every day. I love theology. I love correct. Theology just means the study of God, and I love a correct study of God. I think God has been so misconstrued in the church at large, it's pretty sad actually. And so I love to study God, and I love to be accurate. And I pray on a constant basis, God, make sure I represent you correctly. Because a teacher is judged more strictly. And so I endeavor to find out the most accurate view of God that I can. And with the help of people like a David Ravenhill, or his dad, or Pastor Gary, or others, I've had great wise counsel over the years. And so there's something in our theological genre, if you will, that is called the law of first mention. And what that means is the first time something is ever mentioned in the Bible probably serves to define it. Because any author knows that the first time you introduce a term, you have to define it there so that it makes sense throughout the rest of the book. You wouldn't introduce a term and then define it 50 pages later, because you need to let people know what you're even saying. And so the same applies with the Bible. And by the way, I've dealt with this a lot. Everybody just say, take the Bible at face value. Some people try and get so spiritual that they don't even read what the text says. Okay? Just read the Bible. It was written to simple people. Read it for what it says, and then you can embellish it if in context. But don't try and grab some spiritual meaning out of something that's obvious. When the Bible says God hates divorce, it means God hates divorce. And usually people who are getting a divorce like to super spiritualize that, like a number one super spiritualized with Dr. Pepper. Hold the pickles and onions, and they say, well, it doesn't really mean that, because I had one person say, it doesn't really mean that because God divorced his wife Israel. Stupid is and stupid does. Yes, it really means that. Okay? Now, nobody fall under a guilt complex if they've been divorced in here. I'm sure there's several circumstances and things like that that have played out. But nonetheless, just because somebody's been divorced and I could risk them feeling bad about it right now doesn't negate the fact that God hates divorce. And you've got to take the scripture for face value. And if you don't take the scripture for face value, you get off and you make a golden calf, and it misrepresents what God is really like. And so we have to take the scripture for face value. So in Genesis chapter 22, verse 5, we see where Abraham and Isaac are going to go up on the mountain. This is such a phenomenal story. This is, the book of Genesis lays the foundation for the rest of the Bible. It's called the Book of Beginnings. And so God tells Abraham to take his son. And here's what's really an interesting distinction. He says, take your son, the son that you love, and go up on the mountain. Well, what's interesting about this is the same mountain that they went up on is the same mountain where Jesus died. Because God had to take the son that he loved, and have him sacrificed there. But see, Abraham had to carry it out physically so that God could carry it out spiritually. God always moves off of when somebody does something, because it grants him access on the earth. And so there's a double dichotomy here, but let's take it for face value like I just said. Abraham, how did Abraham ever get Isaac? Does anybody know? God comes to him, and don't everybody speak at once. So he looked at me like a dog in a new pan. God comes to Abraham and says, you're going to have a son. He gets so excited about it. Well, years go by, right? And him and Sarah are like, he's like, Sarah. Some of you remember that? All the young people are like, what's happening? He's like, we haven't had a kid yet, and you're barren, and God told us we're going to have a kid. And so what Sarah says, which is so weird, she says, why don't you sleep with my servant Hagar, and then we can have us our kid. Because they weren't willing to wait for the promise through faith and patience, but they tried to expedite the process. And Abraham's like, no, honey, I could never do that. Well, he didn't. He's like, yeah, whatever you want, babe. Sure. So Hagar comes in, and they sleep together, and they have what's called Ishmael. Now, Ishmael was not planned by God. That throws all the predestination out of the water. God comes up and he's like, what'd you guys do? And they're like, well, you promised it. If God ever promises something, let him bring it to pass. Because anything done out of the flesh is going to be an Ishmael. It's not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. We're still plagued with Ishmael today. Something birthed out of the flesh. So, finally, over a period of more time, they have a son named Isaac, which is laughter. And the reason why they named him laughter is because they were so excited that they had a son when they were way past childbearing. I mean, she's 100 years old and he's 120. The pipes don't work anymore and they have a kid. And so when Isaac pops out, she goes, oh, let's name him Giggle, because this is just amazing. And boy, I'll tell you what, Abraham fell in love with this boy, the son he loves. And he had every right to. God gave it to him. I've had God give me some stuff, and I just love it. I love it. But there's a problem when I begin to love it more than I love him. And I wonder if Abraham began to have such a fond affection for Isaac. I mean, they were besties. They loved each other. And it was reciprocated. And God tells him one day, Abraham, take the son that you love, your only son. By the way, he had two sons. But God never recognizes what's birthed out of the flesh. Write that down. God never recognizes in our ministry what's birthed out of the flesh. Anything that you try to do out of your own effort to please God is an Ishmael. Let it come to pass. That includes trying to get your relatives saved. You want your relatives to get saved? Babies are conceived out of intimacy. You worship God, they'll get saved. If you try and leave tracks all over the dresser in the bathroom, you're birthing an Ishmael. They need to see somebody who loves Jesus, and they'll want to love him too.